All right, so last time what I did is I showed you that general from end to end stress strain curve. But if we actually take a tendon, and remember what I told you the job of a tendon was, it was to attach a compliant or stretchy muscle to a stiff bone. All right, so now if we take a tendon and we, instead of looking at it and pulling on it like this, we'll hold on to the muscle and the bone, and we pull on it, we just get the stress strain curve of the whole thing. If we actually take it and we pull on it, but we look at the bone end, or we look at the muscle end, this is the paper that I gave you, which is from Ellen Aruda, who's an incredible, she's an incredible bioengineer at the University of Michigan. And what she and her group did is basically put little lines on the tendon throughout the length of the tendon, pulled on using the muscle and the bone, and then watched the lines on the muscle end of the tendon and the bone end of the tendon and the middle part of the tendon. And then what she could do is she could calculate how much strain or how much stretchiness you had near the muscle, how much stretchiness you had near the bone. And what she found was really different than what we saw in that one single stress strain curve for the whole tissue. And that's that at the muscle end of the tendon, when she only looked at the muscle end of the tendon, it looked like this. It was highly compliant. What that means is you stretch it a long way with a little tiny bit of load. So at a low load, you're stretching the muscle end of a tendon a long way. At the bone end of the tendon, the bone end of the tendon is right here. So the bone end of the tendon is already stiff as a bone. So the bone end of the tendon, you pull on it really hard and you barely stretch it at all. So across the whole length of the tendon, this is the average stress strain curve. It goes up just like we saw. There's the toe region, and now it's going to go into the linear region, and then it's going to go up and it's going to fail. But what it's telling us is that tendons don't work as a single tissue. It works mechanically as if it's two, at least two different tissues, probably just a rainbow of different tissues. Because at one end, it's very stretchy. If you go a little bit further, it's less stretchy. Go further down, and you go from something very slowly, you turn from compliant to stiff. And that's the function of a tendon. When it does that, it can act as a shock absorber. Now we do a movement. Now the muscle is contracting really hard. The muscle end of the tendon stretches a lot. That protects that whole muscle from injury. It works like a shock absorber. Stretchy muscle end of the tendon. But if you had stretchy bone end of the tendon, then it would be a really big transition from the tendon to the bone. So what you have is you have within the tissue, there's the muscle end, there's the middle of the tissue, where it's already really stiff, and there's the bone end of the tissue where it's as stiff as the bone already. So what you get is you get this progressive slow movement of stretchy to stiff within the one tissue, and that is protecting both the bone from pulling off a chunk of bone and the muscle from some pulling the muscle. When we train, what we do is we change the stiffness of the muscle end of the tendon. If we train really fast, we're going to make this stiffer. And if we train it really slowly, we're going to make it less stiff. So how do we get this regional variation in stiffness across the length of the tendon? Well, it goes back to what our myotendinous junction looks like. Okay, so this is where the muscle, you can see the muscle here with the striations, and you can see this beautiful electron micrograph. And then you can see the collagen molecules here of the tendon. And what you can see is they don't come together like this. They don't come together just touching. They come together like this. They come and they interdigitate. You see digits or fingers of muscle going into the tendon. You see fingers of tendon coming into the muscle. That's really important for a lot of reasons. Mechanically, this makes this a lot stiffer and a lot stronger. So whenever you were a kid and you were running around getting into trouble like me, what we would do is we wouldn't put our hands together like this to give our friend a boost over the wall. Because if I put my hands together like this and said, "All right, put your foot in there and I'm going to heave you up over the wall," all that's going to happen is you're going to put your foot there. I'm not going to be strong enough to hold it together. This is going to be loaded in tension. It's just going to pull apart. So what did you do? Simple. You went like this. And now you said, "All right, put your foot in my hands, and now I can lift you up," because now, look at what I've done is I've increased the surface area of attachment. So I've gone from this little area to this huge area. So now the surface area of attachment is huge. Secondly, now instead of pulling and loading this way in tension, Now what we're doing is we're loading in what's called shear. So you can see that as I'm pulling really hard, I can slowly, but they have to slide past each other. And when they slide, now what's going to happen is that's going to give me a lot of extra space and time to resist the load. So that's why this interface is really important. As far as how does it make the tendon, the muscle end of the tendon less stiff, think about it. If I've got this and I'm pulling a little bit on this one more than I'm pulling on this area of the tendon, more than I'm pulling on this, now what you've got is you've got differences between them. So you're going to get shear. And it's like your cross links within the collagen are like my hairs. I'm super hairy. So if I put a Band-Aid on here and I pull it off, if I pull it off, what I'm going to do is now I've got this shear force that as I'm pulling my Band-Aid off, what it's going to do is going to pull out all this hair. And so when I work slowly, do a slow movement, now I'm going to get the tendon molecules, the collagen molecules, are going to work as individual molecules, just like the water. So now as I move slowly, we're going to get individual collagen molecules or fibrils or fascicles sliding past each other. And now what's going to happen is when that sliding happens, we're going to break crosslinks in between those collagen molecules. And when I do that, what's going to happen to stiffness? Stiffness is going to go down. So if we do the reverse, if we make it so that you can't move your muscle, what happens? And that's what we saw in the paper, where if you take a tendon or a muscle and you cut the nerve to it so that it can't do any activity, and you look at it 5 weeks later, this is like putting a cast on your foot, keeping your foot in that position and not loading your tendons and muscles within the cast. What's going to happen when you take the cast off? You're going to be super stiff. Now, here's the mechanics after injury, following inactivity. And what you can see is what happened over here, where's that muscle end of the tendon? Wow, it's way up here. So now the muscle end of the tendon is as stiff as the bone end of the tendon. So this leads to two things. One thing is if you've got an athlete who's in a cast or in a boot, they're going to go throughout their day. That's, you know, they're trying to heal a bone or they've got like, a stress fracture, stress reaction. What you're going to do is you're going to put them in a boot. They're going to come out of the boot. There's two things that are going to happen. They're going to be a step faster. The reason they're faster is because the muscle end of the tendon is stiffer. So when your muscle contracts, it transmits the force to the bone faster. So that longitudinal transmission of force is way faster. The second thing that's going to happen is they're going to pull the muscle that's associated with that tendon. Why? Because we pull muscles when the tendon is stiffer, then the muscle is strong. So if you are trying to increase stiffness, you're going to do quick movements. Because a quick movement, instead of the collagen fibrils working as individual molecules, they're going to work as a sheet. If I pull quickly, the whole thing works as a sheet, just like water, because it's viscoelastic. Now, instead of getting these shear forces that break crosslinks, I don't break any crosslinks. After exercise, whether you do slow exercise or fast exercise, you increase the enzyme that makes new crosslinks. So you're going to make new crosslinks after exercise. If I've done fast exercise and there's no breaking of crosslinks, I'm going to add more crosslinks, tissue's going to get stiffer. And that's going to continue to go while I train. So now I've trained or I've gotten out of my cast and I'm stiff, that's going to be great for my performance. But then what's going to happen? You're going to pull the muscle associated. Think about the World Championships or Olympic Games, the men's 200 to 400 meter sprints. What you will see every Olympic or World Championship is guys pulling up because they've pulled their hamstring muscle. They've ruptured their hamstring muscle. Basically, what they've done is they've trained as fast as they could to increase their power for months on end. And what they've done is they've increased the stiffness of their hamstring tendons, but they've gone a little bit too stiff. And now the muscle isn't strong enough to absorb, or the tendon is stiffer than the muscle is strong. And then what happens is the tendon is stiff. And so instead of the tendon stretching at the muscle end, what happens is it stays the same length because it is really, really stiff. So now what has to happen is the muscle has to stretch. And if the muscle has to stretch, the muscle fibers have to stretch, what's going to happen is they're going to be stretching when they're contracting. That's a really high force eccentric load. And the result is going to be that we're going to rupture the muscle. So a lot of muscle pulls happen because we've trained to increase stiffness of the muscle end of the tendon. We've made that stiffer. Now the tendon is stiffer than the muscle is strong. And now what we're going to do is we're going to rupture the muscle. So again, just to show you that we can alter stiffness, if you do plyometric training, here are two different studies where they look at joint stiffness. Joint stiffness with plyometric training goes up, and it goes up here. This is lightweight resistance training. You can see that there's not really a change. If you go to heavyweight resistance training, it would come down. And you can see that here. If you've ever been to a physical therapist, or if you're an athletic trainer yourself, and you have somebody with a Achilles tendon problem, what do? You do what are called slow lengthening contractions. It's the Alfredson protocol for improving tendinopathy within the Achilles. And all you do is you do these slow, heavy lengthening contractions, because what you're trying to do is the slow contraction, again, with a lot of weight. Now we're getting nice sliding of the collagen molecules within the muscle end of the tendon. That's going to slowly over time decrease passive tension within the muscle tendon unit. So what I've told you as far as the force transfer component, tendons connect muscle to bone, and they're variable mechanical tissue. The primary protein in tendon is collagen. The collagen is the backbone that provides the strength, and the stiffness and strength of these tendons and ligaments can be increased by cross-linking. And the enzyme that does it is this enzyme lysyl oxidase. You can also do it if you are diabetic or if you don't have good control of your blood sugar through these things called advanced glycation end products. This is one reason why diabetics have a lot more musculoskeletal injuries than non-diabetics. The water in a tendon or a ligament means that it's viscoelastic. That means if you load it faster, it's going to be stiffer. And if a tendon gets stiffer than a muscle is strong, the result is going to be muscle injury. And again, this is most obvious whenever we're trying to be our best. So the world championships or other things where we've worked to increase our performance by making ourselves stiffer so that we can transmit force better, but we haven't done enough protective movements. And the result has been that you rupture the muscle. All right, so all of this has been talking about the tendon, where it's a healthy tendon. Now what's going to happen is my PhD student Danielle is going to come in and tell you what to do, or how strength training affects a problem tendon, so a tendon that's tendinopathic.